Welcome back, confidants, to another educational, healthy, informative episode of Confidently Insecure, the podcast where we are absolutely sure we don't know everything. I am your host, Kelsey Darragh, and boy, oh boy, is this week's topic something I am terrified about. I'm so excited to introduce this. This week's guest is not terrifying. Oh, no. She's like the opposite. She's like a warm hug, your sister, your BFF on TikTok. I'm sure you've seen her viral videos. She is Christy Snodgrass, but on TikTok, you are Christy PRN, and you are a nurse and a nurse advocate. So Christy, thanks so much for coming on the pod.
Thanks for having me, Kelsey. I'm so happy to be here.
You are just like a ray of fucking sunshine in a topic that is like so cloudy and dark. And I just have to commend you for like your bold, brash, brazen. When you popped up on my For You page, I was like, oh my God, this woman is doing the Lord's work. And I just had to reach out. You were like, yes, let's talk. And I want to like ask, how do you describe what you do to people who maybe haven't seen your TikToks before?
So now, you know, I've been a nurse for 8 years. I told the story on my TikTok, but I recently quit my job so that I could full-time advocate for what is essentially healthcare reform. I like to just educate people on what's going on in the healthcare field, because I think that the public is very unaware of how healthcare is working and how it's affecting both, you know, patients and healthcare workers. So that's what I do now. I'm not involved in any policy writing, political, none of that.
Yeah.
My job now is just to educate the public and have them do what they please with that information.
Amen. And I think that's why I was like so terrified of this subject, is it's because like healthcare and healthcare reform is something that does seem so like adult, and I'm 31, like I'm a full grown adult, and I'm still like, no, that's like an adult thing, like your mom calls.
My thing.
Yeah. And it does feel so rooted in politics. It can feel very unapproachable. It can feel very like there's no world in which I think of healthcare and not feel incredibly stressed out and sad, and like it becomes a chore on my to-do list of life. But I mean, first of all, back it up just a hot sec. You were a nurse for 8 years. Thank you so much for everything you've done. Wow. And I'd love to know.
I loved it.
Yeah. Well, tell me what like the last year of your life personally and professionally has looked like. Like Jesus.
Yeah. Where do I start?
Right.
So this last year, I've been working like more on the administrative side of nursing. So I was a bedside nurse, you know, taking care of patients for 5 years. After that, I moved on to a role called case management. So my job in the hospital basically was to do this impossible balance of getting the patient what they need while still looking after the hospital's bottom line. And spoiler alert, it's not possible. It should be. So that's what I was doing this past year before I quit my job. And then COVID hit and I experienced the type of burnout that I have never experienced in my nursing career. You know, I've experienced burnout before where I just didn't want to go to work. I was always so stressed out. I had so much anxiety. And that's one type of burnout that I'm familiar with. But the type of burnout I you know, experienced last year was the type of burnout where I was just apathetic at one point. Like you just, and it's not that you're not compassionate to your patients. It's not like you don't care or you're kind, but when you stop feeling bad, that is a dangerous place to be in, especially for any healthcare worker.
So I
started experiencing that last year, and I started talking to, you know, my family, my husband, and I'm like, I don't want to do this anymore. I went into this side, the administrative side, because I thought like, hey, maybe if I'm on this side, I can help the patients more.
Right.
And it just wasn't possible. I felt like I was a part of a system that was very manipulative.
Yeah.
And it wasn't the doctors. It wasn't the nurses.
Sure,
it wasn't
sure.
The people on the ground actually taking care of the patients. Sure. It was just the system, which we have set up here. It's not patient focused. And I felt like I couldn't do enough inside the system. So I thought I'm going to leave the system and see what happens. So that's what my past year has been like. And
yeah,
it's been a little crazy, but I'm winging it.
I mean, honestly, like it gives me chills. Cause I see you as like this whistleblower. Like you really are someone who saw the system inside to out. I mean, you knew the bedside care, you know what that takes, you know what that looks like. Then you get into the weeds of it where you're working for the man, let's say. It's right. Definitely a man who's running all this shit.
Yeah,
that for sure.
And, we know that.
Yeah. And then for you to be so like, I can't think of another word, but like, fuck it. You were just like, fuck this and fuck it. And I am going to tell you guys the truth of what I've seen. And from it coming from you feels so much different than a news reporter or a patient, because there isn't like neutrality in those situations. And you really right. bring that neutrality of like, listen, I'm not saying everybody's an angel who comes to the hospital, but I'm also not saying that the hospital is an angel. And you are able to talk about an array of subjects, from things of like COVID and vaccines and vaccinations, all the way to specific line items on a bill, to, you know, like just the stuff that all of us regular folk just shudder at when we think of the healthcare system. Do you feel like as important as you are? Because you are.
No. So Kelsey, this has been a wild ride.
I bet.
Keep in mind that my TikTok is like 6 months old. So it's like zero to like 350,000 in less than a year.
Oh my
so gosh. I'm like flying by the seat of my pants right now. And I've met with several different organizations within mm-hmm. the past week. They're like, what's your plan? I'm like, a plan?
interesting idea. A plan.
Like I should get one of those. That's a good idea.
No, but I mean, like, that's also like when you become public facing, now you're entering like my territory. Now you're in like influencer world. I hate to say the word influencer. I much prefer,
doesn't it make you shudder a little bit, where you're just like, oh,
it's not our fault. It's society, but like creator, advocate, ally, yeah. Like there's a whole business side of this that, like, girl, we can talk offline. Like I could talk you through that. Like we should definitely have a side conversation.
Yeah, please do help me, Kelsey. Yes. Help me.
But are you like, and this might be like a bold question, but are you like afraid at all of these companies or hospitals or insurance companies like coming after you?
Oh, 100%. And it's not just hospitals or insurance companies. It's like, I have major imposter syndrome, like every single day. Like I am just a nurse, came off the bedside. I know, you know, a little bit about the administrative side, but I am not the smartest person in the world. I don't know everything. And I will fully admit that up front. I am just trying to open up the conversation, but I think about that all the time, where somebody's going to come back at me and be like, oh, well, who's this, you know, RN with no pertinent degree here. Like,
if we all know, I feel like the majority of the world knows that like the nurses are the people really that know what's going on. Like the doctors, we all think of like Grey's Anatomy, like God complex scene. We're like, the nurses are the real deal. But like you definitely are ripping the Band-Aid and like kind of opening the curtain behind these subjects that, like, what gets to me the most about what you're talking about is like, we have been believed our whole life as a society that a hospital is the number one safest place, the place that's supposed to help you, that never lets you down, can fix it all. And I learned from your TikTok so much, but one thing I learned is that the number one cause of bankruptcy in America is healthcare debt, or like, what's the proper term? Is it health?
Yeah, medical debt. Yeah.
Medical debt. What? And no one's talking about this.
It's
no one's
insane.
Like, so
we are going bankrupt to stay alive. Like, this blows my mind. And I have people from like all other countries. Now I'm not getting into the whole debate, but I have people from all other countries who are astounded
yes.
that America has to pay so much mm-hmm. to stay alive. Mm-hmm. And it's funny because I just watched this TikTok the other day of this guy who was going around, I think he was in the UK, and asking people like how much they thought things cost in America. And he would go up to people and he'd be like, how much do you think it costs to have a baby in America? And they're like, it costs to have a baby in America?
Yes.
Like you're paying money to have a baby in America? Like it's just... But that's what we've been conditioned to do. Like we don't know any different. So whenever we start to open up the conversation, people are just so used to how it's been that they don't know what it could be.
Right. And we don't know how to self-advocate either. Again, because insurance is built to be so confusing and so non-helpful in my opinion.
Right.
Like we're constantly like, oh, thank God I have insurance because of this thing. And I know the video exactly that you're talking about. There's another guy too that I think you would love on YouTube. I forget his name. I'll find it and link it below. But he brings other healthcare workers from different countries to play like a game with him where they guess certain prices of things. And like then you get that healthcare worker's response too of like, what? No, what it actually costs the hospital is this. And like what you're being charged is this. That's crazy. And so I guess like, you know, I have to imagine those hatery comments, of course, stand out to you. Of course, I'm sure they get to you. But also, like, you have to know how many people you're helping to understand their own rights to become their own advocate.
Yeah, and Kelsey, that is my main goal. That is why I have a TikTok. You know, I have those funny videos in there because I got to get my weirdness out. I just
we love that.
I need an outlet. But my main goal of my TikTok is to just get the people the resources they need so they know their rights and they know how they can advocate themselves, and not just patients, but nurses and doctors. There's this big misconception that healthcare is run by healthcare workers, and it is not. Even in that TikTok that blew up about, you know, the pricing transparency, people were on there like, oh, these doctors are just charging so much. And I'm like, doctors have zero control over your prices in the hospital. I don't know if you know that, but doctors do not set the prices. They don't even know the prices.
Yeah.
And the amount of healthcare workers that come on my platform and are like, what? This is happening? Because I didn't know. As a bedside nurse, I had no idea what anything cost whatsoever. And patients would ask me and I would look around like trying to find somebody who knew the answer, and you can't. So much of this is negotiated on the back end, which is another just thing that blows my mind. Like you have no idea what kind of debt you're going to go into when you go into the hospital, and you have to just get the services and find out later.
Yeah.
And that's a little backwards.
I loved the like comparison you made on your TikTok about like the car salesman. You're like, imagine if a car salesman was like, you need this, you have to buy this car, but I'm not going to tell you the price until after, because I don't want like our competitors to see, because we care about you. And you're like, oh, well, when you put it that way, it does seem so fucked up. And like, I'll try not to get too into the weeds of like any specific instances. So I guess like, and also we have a large international audience on this podcast too. So I feel like they're also going to be just like shocked and horrified, and all the comments are going to be filled with people just being like, wow, our healthcare is free or like universal, or, you know, we don't even have to pay for that sort of thing.
Right.
I guess like my overarching question is like, what the fuck are we supposed to do? Right. Like I take in all your information, I soak it in, and then I'm like, what do I do about it? What can I as a person do about it?
That is the big question, Kelsey. And I've been partnering with other organizations who actually are working on the political side, but it doesn't matter how much policy that you write, how much you campaign, if the public is not aware, they're not going to vote for it. So that again is the part that I'm working on. The more that we share this info, the more that it's out there, the more that the public is educated about it, the more we'll be informed whenever that policy actually hits the table. We'll know, oh, this is what we need to vote for. I'm educated on this. I know what's happening now. This is what needs to change. Right. And that's where I'm at. Other organizations are pushing it forward, like on the policy and the political end. But I'm just making sure that the public has the information they need to make an informed decision.
Right, right. And I think that that's like the most important part, arguably. Like I said, you're kind of like the Wizard of Oz guy behind the curtain that's like, I'm revealing it all to you and like, do what you will with this information.
Yeah.
And I think it's like, it's such a breath of relief too that you do make the silly ones, because it's such a frustrating topic. It's so nice to see you being human and seeing you being sassy and like responding back to comments with science. Like I think that that's exactly the attitude we have to take. And I wanted to get your opinion too on being a woman in healthcare who, you know, I've done a lot of content around chronic pain in my life, and I've done a lot of advocacy work on women in the chronic healthcare, chronic pain community, of just how we are often underrepresented, aren't listened to, even marginalized women have it 10 times worse. Did you see like firsthand one or the other of seeing like how people are treated in hospitals? Because I know you have, because I've seen some of your TikToks about like donors and things, but I'd like you to kind of also pull back that curtain a little bit more too.
Yeah. So as far as my role, like nursing is obviously a female dominated profession. I also think that that's probably why it's a highly abused profession. I think that's why we're not paid well. I mean, that's not the only reason why. There's a multitude of reasons. But I did see this whenever I was working in the hospital. Even though the grounds people are mostly women, the upper management has a lot more men. And there was, you know, it's kind of a difficult subject to approach, because I never like felt myself like I was being singled out for anything, but I do feel like I was not taken seriously. Like I was whining, like I wasn't strong enough. You know, if you can just be more resilient. And that is a characteristic that is drilled into nurses. You need to be more resilient. You can't be crying over everything. You need to toughen up. And I think that is just so detrimental to how we need to be, especially for our patients. Now, we can't be blubbering in a corner every time a person dies. Like, I get that. Like, there needs to be some coping mechanisms there. But this idea that we just need to take it and take it and take it has led to what is now happening in our profession, where there is a mass exodus, where women and men and nurses are saying, I'm not doing this anymore. I'm not going to be treated like this. I'm not going to be paid like shit and treated like shit. No. In fact, one of my fellow TikTokers that I love says this line that I absolutely love. She says, you can treat me like shit or you can pay me like shit.
You can't do both.
So, you know, nurses are just sick of it. So there's been a mass exodus, and people think that it's solely because of COVID, and COVID was the last straw, definitely. But it's been escalating over years. We've been begging for safer staffing for years. We've been begging for better pay for years, better care for our patients, and it's just not happening. So nurses are all, okay, bye, I'm out.
And I think that that's like such a big, that's something that regular old folks are seeing and are terrified of, because we're going like, again, oh shit, the one place that I'm supposed to go for help, like they're not okay. So how are we going to be okay? And then you get the conspiracies and the hoaxes and the don't trust the hospitals and blah, blah, blah. You get all that. And it's so misleading, because again, like it all comes back to this idea of like the system is broken and we have to dismantle that column somewhere. And if it's coming at the expenses of nurses, it's like, fuck, that's the wrong brick to be taking out of the wall.
Exactly. It's such a fine line to toe to, especially what I'm doing now. I'm making a lot of healthcare workers mad occasionally, because they're like, hey, like we're working in these systems and these patients don't trust us because they don't trust the hospital. So I'm trying to make that very fine distinction of like, Hey, it's not your healthcare worker. It's not your doctor. Right. It's not your nurse, your respiratory therapist. It's not them. We need to be putting the blame on the people that need to carry the blame. And that is mostly insurance companies and hospitals, yes, because they're the one doing this back and forth with the prices. They're the one saying what patients can and can't get. And, you know, it hurts the patient, but it hurts us too. Mm. So it is such a hard, a fine line to toe, because I want to reveal what's happening in the healthcare system, but I want to be very clear that the large majority of healthcare workers you can trust.
You guys, I feel like you could just do this ad read with me at this point. I don't even have to like look at my notes. I don't have to pull up the copy. This brand and company is just so close to my heart. I wish I could like tattoo. Maybe I will tattoo them across my body at some point. Anyways, you know, I am talking about BetterHelp. If anything is interfering with your happiness or preventing you from achieving your goals, BetterHelp will assess your needs and match you with your own licensed professional therapist. It's safe, private, online environment, so convenient that you can start communicating with a therapist in under 24 hours. With my personal experience, I just switched therapists and I was manifesting a young, witchy boss bitch. And I was like, there's no way this exists in a therapeutic community. Well, guess what? It does. It did. I found her on BetterHelp. I'm obsessed with her. I am so excited to talk to her this week. We just got back from our European vacation and I have so much to catch her up on. And I could have done sessions with her while I was in Europe. That's how easy it is to schedule. I do video sessions. I message her all the time and she gets back to me within 24 hours. We can talk about anything. They have therapists who specialize in depression, anxiety, relationships, sleeping, trauma, anger, family conflicts, LGBT matters, grief, self-esteem. There are so many people that have been using BetterHelp that they are recruiting additional counselors in all 50 states. I want you to start living a happier life today. As a listener, you're going to get 10% off your first month by visiting betterhelp.com/CI. Join over 1 million people taking charge of their mental health. Again, that's BetterHelp, HELP.com/CI. My sweet confidants, I want to tell you about HelloFresh, where you can get fresh, pre-measured ingredients and mouth-watering seasonal recipes delivered right to your door. Skip trips to the grocery store and count on HelloFresh to make home cooking easy, fun, and affordable. That's why it's America's number one meal kit, baby. You know I am all about that life of not having to leave my house if I don't have to, and especially if I don't have to spend that much money, which is why I love HelloFresh. And especially with fall coming up, hello, we know we are busy. We've got back to school, back to life, but HelloFresh recipes save time you'd otherwise spend meal planning, shopping, so you can get back to what matters. You know, like watching TV in sexy time with your friends. And HelloFresh's family-friendly menu is a big win for back-to-school season with easy, delicious recipes for drama-free dinner. I got the Calorie Smart Box because I did just come back from a European vacation and mama, you know, needs to just be feeling good and fresh. I had so many different kinds of carbs and inflammatory foods that I was like, I need a nice little refresher, a little breaksies from the croissants. So I got the Calorie Smart Box and let me tell you, Jared has been having such a great time cooking them. I sit back, relax, make him put on an apron. He gets some like little Italiana bossa nova music playing and he cooks for his queen. That's right. You can go to HelloFresh.com/confidently14 and use code confidently14 for up to 14 free meals, including free shipping. That's going to HelloFresh.com/confidently14 and use use the code confidently14 for up to 14 free meals, including free shipping. HelloFresh, America's number one meal kit. Right. And has nothing to do with this trickery. Yeah. Which it feels like. Yeah. It feels like. And I love the line you use, and I'm like thinking about using it for the title of this episode, of like, hospitals think you're stupid. Hospitals think you're dumb. Yeah. And like, here, I'm going to give you like the weaponry you need to be like, oh, no, no. And I actually did that for and anyone who's listened to the podcast knows the episode about where I accidentally stuck a boric acid pill up my urethra instead of my vagina. And I went to the emergency room because it was so painful. And then when I got the bill, oh, and they didn't do anything, by the way, the doctor like looked at it and was like, you're fine. Just wait for it to like, melt. Yeah, wait for it to melt. You're not going to get boric acid poisoning. And I was like, okay, thank God. And the bill came back as like, it charged $40 to take the pills from the tray and like self-administer the pills. And I was like, oh, well, I'm absolutely not paying that. Like, I'm going to call them and say no. And I didn't even know I had that right or power as a patient, because again, it feels like they level up hospitals, and there is like a sector of the hospital, tell me if I'm wrong, that is some sort of like patient advocacy payment people that do help.
There are in a lot of hospitals. Yeah.
And it toes that difficult line of like, well, at the end of the day, they work for the hospital and they are going to have to protect that at all costs. But also, why are they in a job of advocacy if not to really advocate for patients? I don't know.
Definitely, Kelsey. And that is one of the things that just pisses me off. I hate the fact that in order to advocate for patients, I had to quit my job. I had to quit my job as a nurse to avoid retaliation for advocating for other nurses and patients. Like, how does that make sense in any way? It's just this fine line that we toe, because they have these positions in the hospital, patient advocates, or what I did was case management, trying to get, you know, all the things that a patient would need in a hospital. And it's funny because that was my job, to get the patient safely through their hospital stay and get them whatever supplies that they needed at home as well. And yet every day we would go to these meetings called length of stay, because how long a patient stays in the hospital is very important to the hospital.
Yes.
And every day I would sit with administrators who would listen to my patients' cases and say, do they really need that? Should you get them that therapy? And I'm like, yes. Right. They need it. And there's occasionally times where I can make do, but we aren't doing what's best for the patient. We're trying to give them the least amount possible so that it doesn't come back on us. That is exactly what they wanted us to do. Give the patient the least amount of care possible so that we don't get sued. And that's what it's about now. And I cannot take it. Now there's these opposite effects that happen too, right? So, cause some procedures make a lot of money. Mm. So there's sometimes that we're doing extra that we shouldn't be doing.
Yeah.
But the large majority of the time, it's like, give the patient just enough to get them by and then send them out the door.
Right.
And you know, I can't do that. How am I supposed to be in a role where I'm advocating for the patient, yet I have administration down my back every single day telling me, give them less, give them less, give them less. So it's really hard.
And it's crazy because I'm sure those people that are in those administrative positions don't interact with people on a daily basis and don't know them personally and don't know their, you know, I say sob story, but it really makes you sob, their story. And that's what like the problem with the American healthcare system is we're treating us like cattle and not like people. It's like, let's get them in, let's get the most out of them and get the least responsibility. And I think, so you've got like villain one, right? Which is like these big hospitals, not the healthcare workers themselves, but the actual like hospital people. And then you've got villain number two over here, which is your fucking insurance people, the insurance companies. No. And I don't even know where to begin with the insurance conversation. I don't even know how to start it.
It is insane because I've been a nurse for 8 years and I'm like scratching the surface of how complicated our insurance companies are. And if I don't get it, the public sure as hell doesn't get it.
I don't get it.
It's meant to be that way.
Right.
I mean, they do all these things. You have to go through, you know, all these different processes just to get the minimum amount of care that you need. It's crazy the amount of stuff that I had to do in the hospitals. Like to get a patient oxygen, I had to fill out 5 different forms. They had to go through 5 different tests. And then at the end of all that, and I have a video on this, at the end of all that, if the insurance did not think their diagnosis was good enough to have oxygen, too bad. Go home, die, I guess. Like, don't breathe. I don't, you know?
Right.
It's insane because these insurance companies are practicing medicine. That's what that is. The doctor is supposed to be dictating what a patient needs and doesn't need based on their assessment. The patient is right in front of them. We have eyes on them. Insurance company never sees them. And we can give them all the documentation in the world showing how much a patient needs what they need. But if the insurance company decides that that's not good enough, then they're stuck. And I know the argument is made all the time. Well, they're not practicing the medicine because, you know, the patient can still get it. They'll just have to pay out of pocket. No, they can't, because then the hospital charges them tens of thousands of dollars for that procedure, whatever it is that they need. So they literally, hospitals and insurance companies, back you into a corner. So you have to depend on both of them, yet you can't, you don't get what you need.
Right.
Insurance companies is just like,
that's, it's a whole nother, like, and there's no way to talk about that without talking politics with universal healthcare and privatized insurance. And I know you've done some videos on it where you break it down. And I love that you use graphics because I'm a visual person. So if you were just talking to me, I would be like, I still don't get it. I know you're bringing it down like I'm 5, but I still don't understand. But I think, like, especially, you know, this whole time we've just been assuming you're a regular old person who's had an accident or a sudden condition and you got to go in and you have no choice and you're pushed into a corner. Whereas, like, I also think of it and come from it personally as someone with a condition that, and I don't have to like explain every, you know, how it happened, but I had a surgery on my jaw where a doctor unfortunately damaged and cut the nerve that controls the feeling and movement in my face. So it was something that I went to a hospital to get help for. And then I came out 20 fucking times worse, my life completely different. I mean, this is what I'm actually writing my second book about right now, is about chronic pain and how do we manage and navigate, because I feel that I've been through the Western way of things.
Yeah.
And I've seen what a $250, you know, 10-minute conversation looks like. I've seen what a $10,000 retainer looks like. Like, I've been lucky and privileged enough, obviously, to have insurance, but I'm paying $600 a month for insurance to have to then go see specialists who aren't covered by my insurance anyway. Like, part of me is like, what the fuck, what is the point of insurance if at the end of the day?
What the fuck is the point? Like, seriously. And I've talked about this too. I have a son with autism and it's insane because my husband and I are now self-employed. We pay for private insurance. We pay $1,000 a month,
my face
for all of us. And then my son, you know, goes to different therapies, and none of his, they exclude him.
Before he ever had a chance, before they even ever knew him.
They excluded him. They have the clause that says no services for autistic diagnosis, none. And not medications, not therapies, not special doctor visits, none. So in addition to paying $1,000 a month, on top of that, we pay like probably $700 to $800 more a month just to get him the therapies that he needs, because it's all out of pocket.
And this might be a dumb question, but like in your case, is there a way, and this might also be a question you were like, I don't fucking know, but is there a way to ever take a diagnosis off of your like insurance chart? Like, could you go like all of a sudden, like, just kidding, that doctor messed up. We're really not here with an autistic diagnosis. Like, is there a way to ever start anew as a brand new person? With
it? You know, like, I don't know what the legal answer is, but whenever we switch insurances, I look at what they cover and what they don't cover. And then
we are those people. Yeah. That's me. I am the same way. I'm like, I don't know. But you know, what's crazy, and this is a little bit of a tangent towards mental health, healthcare, which is healthcare.
Yes.
I've heard of friends of mine that have been tweeting because they're comedians and they're in the entertainment business about their mental health conditions. And mm-hmm. then insurance companies will deny them certain things and say, well, your tweet says you have depression and anxiety and generalized anxiety disorder. So we are not. And I'm like, wait a minute. Is that legal? And of course it is. They can do whatever the fuck they want. They're a private company.
How are they, like, how do they have this much power?
I cannot know.
Wrap my head around it. Right. It's insane. And mental health care is non-existent.
Yeah.
Not like, don't even get me started. It
go
is
to prison. That's your option, is go to prison or pay $1,000 a month.
Yeah. And what sucks about it is mental health care that is, you know, not being taken care of here in the United States ends up in the ER. Yes. All your social issues, all your poverty issues, all your mental health issues, it ends up in the ER. And then somebody like me who's supposed to get these patients resources in the hospital, I'm like, you have none.
Yeah.
You have none.
So we can't give you things.
Yeah, we can't. I mean, I'll, you know, leave out identifying information. I had a patient or multiple patients come into the hospital needing mental health care. Say it was for maybe a suicidal ideation. Maybe they said they were going to hurt themselves or others. Where I live, we have pretty much one hospital that will take uninsured patients.
Wow.
That hospital has like one floor open. For the size of city that we are, that is unacceptable. Like it's impossible. So what'll happen often is if we can't get the patient placed anywhere, if we've tried our best, tried out of town facilities, nobody wants to take a patient that doesn't have insurance, they will just wait until the patient says, oh, I'm not suicidal anymore. Oh, you're not? Cool. Go home. Like that happened all the time. We were in the hospital. We had the patient. We couldn't get them a bed anywhere where they needed to be in a psychiatric facility. Mm-hmm. So we would wait day after day, reevaluate them. Oh, you're not suicidal anymore? Okay, go home.
Great. Get out now while the window is.
Right. I'm sure you're fine. You said you were fine. So I'm sure you're fine. You know?
Yeah. The story I told about the urethra boric acid pill, there's like a section of that story that I talk about, that there was a private room that we got taken into because the public spaces with the little like curtains being drawn back and forth were filled with people in different versions of psychosis, you know, handcuffed to the bed. And the doctors came in and were like, oh, we're so, you know, I'm not blaming the doctor. Yeah. Sorry. Maybe the patient advocate people would come in and say, we're so sorry about this. Let's take you to a private room. That eventually costed me, by the way. They charged me to go into a private fucking room. That they were trying to keep me away from like this stuff happening in there, that, you know, they'd say they're uninsured or they're unhoused and we can't. And in the way to the private room, in the hallway was a young teenage kid handcuffed to the side of the bed that was just in the hallway that was leading to the door to the private ER room that I got brought into. And I'm sitting there going like, what? I mean, besides being white, female, insured, cis, hetero, like privileged, what can like we do to not make ourselves so specially taken care of? And at the end of the day, it comes down to money. It's like, if you have the money to get the care, and that's not what healthcare is about, right? It's about helping people. And I don't blame you for quitting your job. I commend you. I think we need more people to do that if they are in a position to do so, to say like, this is where we're failing our people. And this is what you guys aren't getting to see. And I mean, like I said, mental health is a whole nother tangent that I could go down, because that's also my you got stories for sure. And I'm just excited to see what you keep exposing and telling us and armoring us with, it as patients. And I guess, like, not to try and put a hat on the whole conversation, but is there some things you could leave us listeners with to prepare us for battle the next time we have to go to the hospital? Or, like, you know, just as patients' rights, like, what are your basic tips or steps, or, like, here's what you need to know for the next time one of us ends up in a hospital?
Yeah. Read what you're signing when you first get into the hospital. A lot of that has, you know, your financial responsibilities on there. And if you don't want to sign it, you don't have to sign it. Hospitals have EMTALA, which is basically a rule that says anybody who comes into a hospital, now there's a caveat at the end, but anybody who comes into the hospital in an emergent, a truly emergent situation has to be treated no matter what, whether they can pay, whether they can't pay, it doesn't matter. They have to be treated. After that, if you can't pay, then they can transfer you out to like a public hospital or whatever. But they cannot technically refuse to treat you in an emergent situation if you can't pay or you won't pay.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. So there is a big one there. The other thing is there's not much you can do while you're in the hospital, but if you have somebody who's trying to push you out of the hospital, wanting to discharge you faster than what you think is necessary. Now, of course, listen to your doctor, because some people want tests that just aren't pertinent to their care. But if you truly feel like this is a safety issue, a lot of times if you have like a Medicare-based insurance, you can appeal your discharge. You can actually call your insurance and say, they're trying to discharge me. I want you to look at all my paperwork from this hospital and see if this is truly a safe discharge or not. And they can actually overturn your discharge. I don't recommend that in all cases, because it's not appropriate in all cases. But still, that is something that you can do too. And then on the back end, when you get your billing, there are a number of different resources you have. I promo $4 on my, on my TikTok, $4.org. They apply you for charity programs, because most hospitals do have charity programs.
Yeah.
It's just not widely known. So if you get a big bill and you think that you might meet income requirements, you can apply for their charity program. In addition to that, there's another company called resolvemedicalbills.com. And what they do is they kind of hit it on all ends. So they will argue with your insurance company if they denied you for something. They'll argue with the hospital to see if they can lower your bill. They'll apply you for charity. In addition to that, they'll try to argue if like the hospital puts you on too high of a payment plan, they'll negotiate your payment plan down.
Wow.
Yeah. So they're like an all-in-one. I just learned about them last week, and I'm like,
wow,
that video about
I feel like that's what everyone needs, is like an assistant to hire.
And if there is anyone out there other than this company, they're doing great. They should have millions of employees. I'm all for it. But if there is anybody out there who wants to do something similar, like create something similar where they're advocating for the patient, that's what we need to be doing. Like, we need to have more people coming over from like healthcare side of it and going to the patient advocacy side. There are a number of different things that you can do. It's hard to navigate as a patient though. I will say that, like, it's better to partner up with somebody who knows what they're doing, because you're easily manipulated in the system, just to be quite honest. You'll believe whatever the hospital or the insurance company tells you, because you don't know any different.
Right.
So if you have these kind of companies who can go alongside you and be like, hey, you know, that's not right, they're not telling the truth, then it makes it a little bit of an easier process.
Yeah. And the advice that I find myself writing about in this next book is, like, for me, it's such an emotionally draining process. Like, I talked to my therapist about it. I'm like, I've got to call my insurance this week, and like, I'm not looking forward to it. And so I find a way to set aside time. Like, I put it in my calendar for like 3 hours, if that's what it takes.
Yeah.
I say, like, I am going to become a relentless Karen in these 3 hours. and call and speak to whoever I need to speak to. I always
speak
ask
to
them,
that manager.
Yes, speak to that manager. I love that. I always ask them to write it down and notate it in my heart. That's like a big one. I'm like, make sure this conversation is recorded on my end as well. I don't give a shit if it's illegal. Yeah. I'm going to fucking record it. Because another thing what happens is they tell you all this gobbledygook to know. And then I'm like, wait, what am I supposed to do again? I'm supposed to call who and the pharmacy and the this and the doctor. And so I record my conversations and I play them back and I like make an action plan, because it's not just something you can go like, oh, I need to call my insurance and like figure it out. It's like,
it's a process every single time. Yes. And that is excellent advice, Kelsey, too. If there was ever a time for Karens, it's when you are dealing with an insurance company or a hospital. I give anybody full permission to be a Karen to the hospital billing department or the insurance, because literally that's what I do. So there's this, and I'm going off on a tangent, but there's this process whenever you're denied for like a procedure or something that you needed from your insurance, called a peer-to-peer, where the doctor from the insurance company will call your doctor who's taking care of you, and they will argue over whether they should be covering that service or not. Wow. Whenever I am talking to doctors who are about to do this peer-to-peer, because it doesn't happen all the time, I'm like, listen, you need to not agree with one single thing that they're saying.
Right.
If they say, oh, maybe you should try this other test first. What? Don't even like, oh yeah, maybe I'll try that. No, like, no.
Just say no.
It's unsafe for the patient. It's unsafe for the patient. It's, you're denying me the care that I need. Mm. So over and over, just, it's unsafe for the patient. I'm not agreeing with you. You're impeding my care. I always tell the doctors, get the name and the, you know, the NPI, which is like their provider number.
Yes.
Of the doctor that you're talking to, and say, guess what? If you deny my patient this care, I'm writing your name all over my chart, because I want you to know that you are the one who denied my patient this thing that they needed. And whenever a patient is calling to the insurance company, they need to be doing the same thing.
Yeah.
No, no, no. I am not going to take this other medication that doesn't work. I am not going to do this scan that's pointless. My doctor wants this, and that is what's safe for me. And if you deny it, I am writing your name everywhere, and you're going to be held accountable. And usually when you are, you know, that much of a Karen to them, they're more likely to give you the care that you need.
It's almost like a test of who can be on the phone longer, I feel like.
Right.
Like, I have no problem. I'll put on a TV show in the background. I'll put the captions on. I'll get a snack and I will just, let's go, honey. And that's also, it's not to villainize also the people who are in the position of answering the most basic of like 1-800-BLUE-SHIELD.com.
I'm not
picking up the phone like, hey, you fucking bitch, take this pill. I'm like, I don't go in that hot. I go in very, it's like a dance. It's like a song. It's like playing a part, and I'm able to get to the level of what I need to. You're probably gonna have to call more than one person. You're probably gonna have to call more than one time a different day. And so that's like, I think my best version of like, we've had this podcast for an hour and it sounds so hopeless, but the truth is guess what? Like, at the end of the day, the insurance company does not exist if you are not paying them money to have insurance. And if you call and you say, I'm going to fucking switch insurance, like, I'm taking my $600 a month that I pay you and I'm going somewhere else. Like, it's like a cable company in a way. And so I don't want people to leave this episode hopeless, because I leave your TikToks anything but hopeless. I get like fired up. And so I want people to know that, like, at the end of the day, as powerless as these systems feel, you know, we do hold a position of power. And I think your advice is so great. Is like, the best armor you can have is the education and the knowledge. And like, I don't know how we're going to make it appealing, because God, this shit is boring as fuck. Like, the code of the medication and the code of the prestige, like, how we're going to make it more interesting for the generations to come, but we're all in this together. It should be something, I think, too, that we aren't afraid to ask for help with. Ask a friend, call one of the numbers you mentioned, the companies. I'll definitely make sure to link those below. But I just think it's so great. I wish I could talk to you forever, but I know that you've got so much to come, and I'm so grateful for what you're doing. And I say this, I'm sure on behalf of many, many people and listeners too, that like, you are so important and you are so valid and needed. And I wish I could suck all that imposter syndrome right out of you with a straw and fucking spit it all over the fuck faces who are actually, in charge of this shit. But please tell the confidants where we can find you and your work and all the brilliance that you're doing for us.
Yeah. So TikTok at Christy PRN. That's my main account. I do have the same handle for my Instagram, and that's pretty much all that I use. I'm working on a website. It will be up soon, and then I'll post it on my TikTok.
Perfect. Well, Christy, thank you so much again. You're so great. I'm sure we're going to chat again soon about all the world of TikTok people. Although I'm going viral for different reasons. I'm going viral for talking about my boyfriend farting into my butt.
I saw that TikTok. That was freaking hilarious.
It's like, can I be an advocate and also talk about my boyfriend farting into my ass? Like,
listen, I have a viral video, Kelsey, of me telling people not to stick potatoes up their butt. So
that makes me feel better. Women are multifaceted. We should be allowed to be multiple things.
Listen, it's 2021. Women can be both funny and smart. We are not one trick ponies anymore, girl.
Say it louder.
We can do both.
Yes, I love it. Okay, Christy. Well, thank you so much. Confidants, don't forget, you can rate this podcast 5 stars on iTunes. If you're going to rate it any less, please don't rate it at all, because I'm very sensitive. Speaking of sensitive, the merch is up, still on Thought Catalog and Shop Catalog. You can also buy the book there and be excited for the second book. And I just had an idea, it just came in my head. So you don't have to say yes, but like, I would love to include an interview with you in my new book. I feel like we should transcribe some of this and like talk about stuff. I feel like that's very needed. Oh my God. Okay, great.
100%.
All right, confidants, we will see you next week. Ta-ta.
Bye.